Good morning. Welcome to the celebration of the seventh Sunday after the Epiphany of our Lord. I recommend that you look at the bulletin extension for all the upcoming events that we will have and do here at Holy Cross. On the calendar section for this evening, we have it marked that there is no wildfire, but we will have wildfire tonight at 6:30. So if you know any youth who are planning or wanting to come, it is available and ready for them. Also, we have the soup kitchen. If you would like to sign up and participate, all the sign up and all the other things are in the welcome center, the welcome room in the hallway. So please sign up and help out with that. And let us begin with our opening hymn. Let us stand. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
Dear beloved, I have good news. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully grant that by your power we may be defended against all adversity, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. You may be seated for our readings.
The Old Testament reading for the seventh Sunday after the Epiphany is from Leviticus chapter 19. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel, and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap your field right up to its edge, neither shall you gather the gleanings after your harvest. And you shall not strip your vineyard bare, neither shall you gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and for the sojourner. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal. You shall not deal falsely. You shall not lie to one another. You shall not swear by my name falsely, and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not oppress your neighbor or rob him. The wages of a hired servant shall not remain with you all night until the morning. You shall not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind, but you shall fear your God. I am the Lord." This is the word of the Lord. You shall do no injustice in court. You shall not be partial to the poor or deaf to the great. But in righteousness shall you judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people. And you shall not stand up against the life of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate your brother in your heart, but you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Do you not know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. For it is written, "He catches the wise in their craftiness." And again, "The Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile." So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world or life or death, or the present or the future, all are yours, and you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand in honor of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the fifth chapter. Jesus says unto you, "You have heard that it was said, 'An eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth.' But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, and what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. You may be seated. Grace, peace, and mercy be unto you from God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Gracious Father, bless us and keep us according to the work and mercy that you have given to us in Christ our Lord. Strengthen our faith that we may bear through all things, and that you, in your grace, sustain us. To this end, use the words that flow from these lips to proclaim your great mercy in Christ Jesus. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, We have our Old Testament lesson and our Gospel lesson, which has, well, quite frankly, scary statements for us. We have in the Old Testament our Lord exercising his power, his might, and he is simply stating who and what he is. I am the Lord. I am the Lord. He speaks and announces who he is, and we get to see that it is his word, his power, his will that will be exercised, that will be given. And he gives to Moses in verse 2, speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. And then we jump to the gospel lesson, where Jesus lays out all the things that we need to be doing as we live in the faith and as we live in our baptismal grace. And then at the very end, the last verse, he says, you therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. These two statements from the Old and the New Testament should frankly scare us. And the reason it should scare us is because God is making command. God is making demand upon us. He is simply saying, do this, be perfect, be holy, and stand before me. Well, that's the scary part, standing before God. For I do not hold up to this holy. I do not hold up to this perfection that is laid before me. And so, what are we to do? How are we to handle this? Are we to just simply look at the gospel and say, oh, Jesus came, everything's okay, and then we get to go and live how we see fit? This is not the life that has been placed before you. In fact, all this is to bring us to an understanding of who God is and what he has done for us. Let us open our hymnals, and let's go to page 292. We'll do a little interaction in the sermon this morning. We have page 292 is the rite of individual confession absolution, or as I like to say, private absolution. And this is, if you so desire to confess your sins to your pastor, we would walk through this. And you will see the title, individual confession absolution. And then right after that line, you have these two little paragraphs of red. Those are called rubrics, and at the seminary, I was taught, you do the red and you say the black. But the red, the first line, says, you may prepare yourself by meditating on the Ten Commandments, and it lists the pages. You may also pray the penitential psalms, and it lists those. Before you would go to confession, you would look at the Ten Commandments, and you would see them, and you would read them. You would not just read the commandment, but you would also read, what does this mean? And in that, you would see what you are supposed to do and what you are not supposed to do. And by reading the commandments, by hearing what God has said for you to do, you quickly come to the realization that you have done nothing to complete what God has placed before you. And that is why you would go to confession, because you would see how you have fallen short of what God has commanded you. And so with this, you see that now the law of God lays before you, in your hands, incomplete. The law of God is given to you so that you would have heaven, so that you would have the glory, so you would know that you have peace with God. But it lays there broken. It lays there incomplete. And with anything broken, with anything incomplete, it's not right. And it doesn't make us feel better. It doesn't build us up. It doesn't strengthen us. In fact, the law before us breaks us. And because it breaks us, we then are in a position of need. We are in a position of dependency. And that is, again, why we go to confession. Because when we hear the words of our Lord, you, therefore, must be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Again, the Ten Commandments, complete and do perfectly. Well, I have failed that with my first breath. And then the words that our Lord gave to Moses, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy. With these two statements and with the Ten Commandments placed before us, with the law of God before our eyes, before our heart, we see how we are unable to do what God has placed before us. And again, at the onset of this sermon, I said these statements are scary because these are the demands that God places upon us. And when we start looking at how far we have fallen, at how far and how we have not done what God has said, we come to the realization that we are simply dependent completely on what God does and delivers to us. We look at the commandments and see our failures, and we look to God and we see His mercy. We see His peace. We see His forgiveness. For God, in His love, in His mercy, sends forth Christ our Lord, and He is the one that completes what has been laid before us, God's law, God's will, God's command. Because you have not been holy, because you are not perfect, like your Father in heaven is perfect, God sends forth His Son, and He completes, He fulfills the law. He walks the way that we are to. He is the one who is perfect and stands before God. And even in His perfection, He takes upon our sin, our incompleteness, our inability, and stands before God and says, "As if I have sinned." And He takes each and every disobedient act, every doubt, every sin that we have committed, and He takes the punishment, and then turns and bestows His holiness, bestows His perfection upon us. And it is there that we once again see that all things have been completed for us. We have life. We have peace. We have the wrath of God taken away and the love of God lavished upon us. Because we have these things, we now have a new and different perspective of our life here in the midst of the fallenness of this world. We see that God loves. We see that God bestows peace and mercy to the likes of us, which again causes us to be all that more dependent upon His action, upon His works, upon His love. For when we again look at the words, "You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy," and "You must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect," these bring despair. But we hear in and through Christ, we see in His works, we see in His actions, that they lift us out of this despair. They hold us in His work, and we cling to this. And this is where faith comes into play. This is where life on this side of heaven is applied to what Christ our Lord gives and renews each and every divine service. It is that His work is given, His work is laid upon, His work is built up upon and in and through us, so that we then, instead of being despaired and beaten and held down by our sin and death, we are lifted up by His gospel, we are lifted up by His work, we are lifted up by His mercy, and we are carried that we may bear through all things. And that is hard, for we live hard lives. We live lives of destruction, let it be by our own hands or by our neighbor's hands or by our sinful flesh or by the simple corruption of this world. We struggle. We have trials. We have temptations. We have pain. We have suffering. But even in this, we are not forsaken. Even in this, we are not lost. Even in this, we are not alone. For God is with us and bears with us in and through all things, showing forth that we first of all have the forgiveness of sins, that we have life, that we have a God who acts to and for us. We have a God who builds us, not destroys us, which brings us to the epistle lesson where St. Paul tells us that we are the temple of God and only He is the one who builds. It is only He who strengthens, and you get to be made holy. You get to be perfected by the work of God, who molds, keeps, and provides you. For you have heard the words that your sins are forgiven. You have heard the words that you shall have life, and life forevermore. And in the midst of this, we again get to see who and what we are now. Let it be through our baptism. Let it be through the strengthening of the very body and blood of Christ. Let it be through the preaching and hearing that your sins have brought you to death and that you have been rescued and made alive in and through Christ. And there is where we find ourselves today. We find ourselves in the life that God has given to us in Christ our Lord. And in the Old Testament, the epistle and the gospel lesson, it is laid before you what you get to do according to the faith that has been provided. You get to love your neighbor. You get to serve your neighbor. You get to live with one another in the love that Christ has bestowed and given to you. And here is the struggle, because we are not holy, because we are not perfect. We struggle with one another. We struggle to show forth the love of Christ in our relationships. After all, we live in a broken world. Why would not our relationships also reflect the brokenness of who and what we are? And so we in the faith, we and what God has made us to be, his people, his saints, we get to do all the more to love one another, to build one another. For we, right here, are the temple, the people, the church of God. And we get to reflect his love and build one another up. For when we are together, if one hurts, we all hurt. When one rejoices, we all rejoice. This is because we have been made one people in Christ. You together have heard that your sins are forgiven. In fact, in our corporate confession, we make the confession, we confess, not I, not him, not her, not the guy in the front who really needs to hear the law, but we together confess that we need what is given here. We confess that we are stuck together on this side of heaven. We confess that we are dependent on God. We confess that we are dependent on one another. For we are to build each other up, not tear each other down. We are called to be little Christs to one another, that is, to show forth love, to show forth mercy, to show forth the grace of God. For how much have you been forgiven? How much have you been loved? And we, in turn, get to look at one another and see each other as the gifts of God that we are, for we have been made holy. Look to your neighbor and see their holiness. Look to your neighbor and see their perfection. Only in Christ. Look to them for strength. Look for them for help. For we are built together. We are the living building. We are the living building blocks of the body of Christ. And we here are being strengthened once again by his love, by his work. Let us hold on to these facts. Let us hold on to these gifts, and let us leave this place built up together that we may serve not just those who are sitting immediately next to you, but the rest of the world. Let them see what has been given to you, and let us not squander these gifts. For you have the forgiveness of God. Wrath has been taken away. Do not seek ways to sin. Do not seek ways to minimize that love, minimize that forgiveness. But hold on to what has been given to you. Change who and what you are, that the love of God may be seen in your thoughts, in your words, and your actions. This has to be one of the hardest things that is placed before us, because we see God, and we see what he has given to us in the gospel, and we so easily move into, we have the forgiveness of sins, and we have freedom. And we abuse that freedom by running to what is comforting to the flesh, what is comforting to our desires. And because we are earthly, because we are fleshly, we so often run to the comforts of our sins. But even those have been taken away in Christ our Lord. Replace that with the love of God and the dependence of what he has given to you to make you his holy, perfect people in and through the faith that has been given to you. For this is yours, and the faith created and sustained by God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Please stand and turn to page 174 and confess our faith as found in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men,
Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are building a living temple for your Holy Spirit out of the church, whose cornerstone is Jesus Christ, your Son. Grant faithful master builders to lay upon this foundation that which will survive the day of his return. Never let us trust or boast in our own works, but only in the work you do by your Spirit through your Son. Lord, in your mercy. When there are divisions in the church on earth, let what is genuine be recognized, that we may always walk the path of your commandments and so please you. Guide us to a reliance on your Son, the one who perfectly loved his enemies. Let us imitate him and be holy as you are holy. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Father, you ask us to pray for our enemies and do good to those who hate us. Help us in this task, that all may humbly come before you, confess their sins, and be reconciled to you and to each other. Let no one be after selfish gain, but rather help us to consider others more significant than ourselves. Do not let us hate our brother in our heart, but instead model the humility of your Son and make peace with our neighbor. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you do not willingly afflict or grieve your children. Look with compassion on those who are suffering in body or mind. Especially this week we ask for Doris, Dana, Greg, and Karen, Kathy, Pat, Marie, Craig, Virginia, Joanne, Frank, Bill, Dorothy, Steve, Mary, Dorothy, Bob, Doris, Nancy, Nate, Dolores, Herbert, Dulce, Tom, Richard, Jeff, Blake, Richard, Linda, Elijah, and we pray for Diana, Dakota, Tom, Jim, Nancy, Chris, Harper, Norma, Charlene, Norma, Garrett, Gary, Elaine, Kelly, Leona, Eloise, Dennis, Peggy, Elfrida, and we pray for Alicia, Margaret, Amy, Mike, Ron, Mona, Bill, Natalie, Christy, Clara, and Mary. Remember them in your mercy, strengthen them in patience, comfort them with the memory of your goodness, and let your face shine on them, that they may be guarded by your peace in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, by your word, give us understanding to keep your law and observe it with our whole heart. By your Son's body and blood, confirm to your servants your promise that you may be feared, our reproach turned away, and life granted us in your righteousness. And Lord, thank you for the wonderful, healthy baby that you have given David and Courtney Odell and Brian and Stephanie Schuler. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, dear Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the offering.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us
forgiveness of all your sins. Take, eat. This is the true body of our Lord.
Truly receive both the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May it strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith. Go and depart in His great peace. Amen.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.